Yeah, hi. I'm going to talk on fetal growth restriction and management. So we'll discuss the management, both the stage-based management as well as the management which is proposed in the recent ISWOG guidelines in August 2020. So we are worried about FGR for fetal growth retardation because we know that there can be a lot. There are associated fetal morbidities, and there can also be a mortality. There is a subset of FGR which is known as severe early onset FGR, where typically at a very early stage we see an FGR, and usually you have a secondary cause like genetic causes, fetal infection, anomalies. This is a different group, and we are not going to discuss this. What we are going to discuss is what we see in day-to-day practice. Now, the first clue that something is going wrong with this fetus, it comes up when you identify a small fetus. So first step is to identify a small fetus, and let us see how to do that. Now, once you have identified a small fetus, we need to differentiate between what is known as a SGA, a small for gestational age fetus, versus an FGR or a fetal growth restriction. We need to look at what time we have picked it up, whether it's early or late. We'll come to that a little later. Once you have diagnosed something as an SGA and FGR, we need to look at some parameters to follow up this fetus to judge their well-being. And then finally, based on all these findings, we need to have some management decisions which can be either be what are known as stage-based management for an early onset FGR, or recently we can follow these ISWOG guidelines which were published in August 2020. So we can say that a fetus is appropriate for gestational age when it is within the normal limits. That means typically if you plot a graph and the growth pattern is well within the 50th percentile, we know that that is appropriate for gestational age. On the other hand, a small for gestational age fetus or a small fetus is one which is basically shows a weight which is below the 10th percentile for all practical purposes. Whereas an FGR fetus is one that has not achieved its growth potential. So as compared to an appropriate gestational age, typically when you see that the weight is gone below the 10th percentile for that gestational age, then we know that we first label this as a small fetus. But we need to understand that of all feti whose weight is less than 10th percentile, almost 70% are what are known as HGA, or small for gestational age, and they do not have any additional risk of perinatal morbidity and mortality as compared to those which show weight which is appropriate for gestational age. And they are very often labeled to as a true SGA or constitutionally small feti, whereas 30% of feti whose weight is below 10th percentile are what are known as FGRs, or true fetal growth restrictions. So we'll see how to differentiate between these two also. Now, being constitutionally small is nothing abnormal. I mean, we know that our ex-external affairs minister, respected Sushma Swaraj, was constitutionally small as compared to the US external affairs minister, but she was very, very efficient. So being constitutionally small is nothing wrong. So SGA, as we said, we define as a fetus whose weight is less than 10th percentile, but it is otherwise healthy with a relatively low risk of perinatal morbidity and mortality. That means all other findings on ultrasound, especially Doppler, is all normal. Whereas an FGR is a fetus who's now, this is a recent classification, of course, published in 2019, a recent definition. So FGR is a fetus whose abdomen perimeter or the weight is below third percentile. So we're not talking about 10th, we're talking about third percentile. Or a fetus whose abdomen perimeter or weight is below 10th percentile associated with an abnormal Doppler. Now, this abdominal Doppler can either be the uterine artery on the maternal side, or the fetal umbilical artery, or the cerebral artery also. And recently, one more thing which has been added is a drop in the percentiles of more than two quartiles, either in the abdomen perimeter or weight. What we mean by that is, suppose a fetus is at 75th percentile, and you see that the fetus has gone to 20th percentile. So 28th percentile is well above 3rd or 10th percentile, but there has been a drop of almost 2 quartiles from 75th percentile, and this is abnormal, and we can classify this as a growth-restricted fetus. So just to summarize, NHGA is a fetus whose weight is below 10th percentile, FGR is a fetus whose weight is below 3rd percentile, or a weight below 10th percentile with an abnormal Doppler, or a drop in the weight or the AC by more than 2 quartiles in a CT scan. So that's how an NHGA fetus shows on the graph. It typically is low, but it maintains its graph, whereas an FGR fetus, as you go, shows a further drop in the weight or the abdomen perimeter as we go towards later on in gestational age. Now, so far we have identified HGA and FGR. Now, we need to differentiate between two phenotypes of FGR, that is an early onset FGR and a late onset FGR. And it is very important to differentiate between them because both of them behave differently as far as outcome and prognosis is concerned. And this difference between early onset and late onset FGR is based on the time of onset or when you diagnose. And for all practical purposes, now we take 32 weeks gestation as a cutoff between early onset FGR and a late onset FGR. That means if you have picked up something before 32 weeks, it is early onset. If you have picked up an FGR after 32 weeks, it is late onset FGR. So just to come back to the definitions, because now we have put up this criteria of 32 weeks gestation, we can say an early onset FGR is a fetus where we have picked up something for growth restriction before 32 weeks of gestation. The abdomen perimeter or weight is below 3rd percentile, or as we said, there is an umbilical artery abnormality like an absent end diastolic flow. Or we have an abdomen perimeter or weight below 10th percentile, as we said, associated with either uterine artery abnormality or an umbilical artery abnormality. Whereas a late onset FGR is something which we pick up after 32 weeks gestation. Again, if the abdomen perimeter or the weight is below 3rd percentile, we have a straightforward diagnosis, or at least 2 of the 3 criteria. That means the weight or the abdomen perimeter below 10th percentile, or with at least 2 of the 3. That means this with either an abnormal CPR or an umbilical artery abnormality, or the AC or AFW crossing more than 2 quartiles. So we have already talked about all this. It is just putting things together. So why the difference? What is the difference between early onset FGR and a late onset FGR? So typically, as we said, early onset FGRs are diagnosed before 32 weeks of gestation. Generally, they would require delivery by 37 weeks of gestation. We cannot wait too long. They are easy to identify because the biometry is florid and you can easily pick it up, but they are difficult to manage because a good number of them are premature. They suffer from chronic hypoxia, and therefore they have a better tolerance for hypoxia. Since the process of hypoxia has been going on for quite some time, they are tolerant to hypoxia. They constitute about 20-30% of all growth restriction fetuses, and a good number of them have an early onset preeclampsia. And therefore, they are picked up very easily, or we are on uterine artery Doppler, and we are suspicious about this when we see an abnormal uterine artery Doppler. Whereas the late onset FGRs, as we said, are diagnosed after 32 weeks of gestation, very often at term. They are difficult to identify because very often the Doppler features are not florid, as we will see later on. They have a poor tolerance to hypoxia. They are not used to hypoxia, and they can constitute to almost 50% of unexplained near-term stillbirths, which are supposed to be because of late onset FGR, which have not been identified. So this is very important, and we have a lot of responsibility here. They constitute almost about 70-80% of all FGRs, and the association with late onset preeclampsia is very low, and therefore the detection rate is very, very poor. Now, the difference between early onset FGR and late onset FGR is like a Sherpa going to the Mount Everest. And one of us who's never gone to the mountain, going to forget about the Mount Everest, going to the base camp of Mount Everest, we would get sick immediately because we are not used to hypoxia. Whereas a Sherpa is used to hypoxia, and therefore there are stories of Sherpas climbing the Mount Everest without even an oxygen. So this is an early onset FGR. They are used to hypoxia. This is late onset FGR. if the fetus is not used to hypoxia, and therefore a slight change in oxygen can actually cause a lot of problems. So now what we have done so far is we have picked up SGA and FGRs. We have picked up early onset and late onset. Now we need to find out how well the fetus is doing inside. Is it quite comfortable inside the change in utero environment? Or is it showing some signs of distress that, okay, things are not too good, I want to come out early? And for this, of course, we now are going to depend heavily on Doppler. Okay? And of course, other things like biophysical profile, etc. So we know that feta react differently to progressive hypoxia at different gestational age, and Doppler is probably the best non-invasive method to evaluate a fetal circulatory change, which can either be adaptive or reactive. So when we talk of Doppler, we know that on the maternal side we have uterine arteries, and on the fetal side we have the umbilical artery, the MCA, and of course we can take the CP ratio now, the ductus, as well as the aortic isthmus. So let's see how different vessels help us. Basically, the uterine arteries and the umbilical arteries give us an idea about the utero-placental function, okay? Whereas, on the other hand, the MCA, the ductus venosus, as well as the aortic isthmus, they give us an idea about fetal cardiovascular adaptation, and they give us an idea about the changes which happen progressively from hypoxia to acidemia. So let's see how we utilize each of these vessels. Now, there are some indices which show a chronic deterioration, for example, umbilical artery or MCA, whereas some of the indices, like typically ductus venosus, show something is going acutely wrong. So this also we need to keep in mind when we take our decisions. Now, when we talk of early onset FGR, we know that early onset FGR is typically associated with the vascular disorder due to the abnormalities of tertiary venous vessel. Most of these are associated with inappropriate trophoblastic invasion of the spiral arteries. And therefore, the typical change in the uterine artery Doppler from high resistance to a low resistance flow does not happen, which is, of course, because of inadequate trophoblastic invasion. And this can be easily picked up by looking at the uterine artery PI. So what we are typically looking at is the uterine artery PI at different gestational ages and trying to find out if it is more than 95th percentile for that particular gestational age, and we know that this is associated with placental insufficiency and maternal vascular malperfusion of the placenta. So typically, therefore, it is very important to look at uterine artery Doppler both in the first as well as in the second trimester. What is the technique? We can do transabdominal as well as transvaginal. We go to the midline. From the midline, we go to the sides, identify the iliac artery, and then identify the uterine artery as it crosses. So typically, we can sample it in an area where the uterine artery is straight. It can be about 1 centimeter downstream as per the guidelines, or wherever you get a good section of uterine artery, but don't go too peripheral to look at branches of uterine artery. And then, of course, we look at the spectral waveform and calculate the PI. Now, it is very important to understand that we now look at only the mean PI. That means we take the mean from both sides. Usually, the machine will do it for us. And we do not look at other things like pre-diastolic notching and other ratios which have been described in the past. And of course, for each gestational age, we need to find out the percentile. But for all practical purposes, if the mean PI is above 2.3 in the first trimester or above 1.4 in the second trimester, that is considered as high. And these are figures which are very easy to remember. Okay, so let's come to the umbilical arteries. So uterine arteries, once they are abnormal, we are alert that, okay, we need to keep a close watch on this particular pregnancy. Now the umbilical arteries, basically a progressive increase in the umbilical artery tells us that there is a progressive reduction in the placental surface area which is available for gas and nutrient exchange, and increased fetal afterload resistance. We talk about this term afterload later. And we know very well that this is associated with placental vascular insufficiency, which ultimately will be reflected in an absent end-diastolic flow or a reverse end-diastolic flow. So we know that normal placenta is quite fluffy, which allows easy exchange of nutrition, whereas a diseased placenta looks something like this and offers a lot of resistance and does not allow easy exchange of nutrition. So when we look at umbilical artery, we are looking at a PI which is again more than 95th percentile. An umbilical artery is both diagnostic as well as prognostic. Diagnostic because we saw earlier that in the definition of FGR also, we used an abnormal umbilical artery as one of the criteria. Okay, but we need to remember that in late onset FGRs, the placental disease is very mild and umbilical Doppler is normal in most of the cases. So we'll come to this point a little later. Now, where do we sample umbilical artery? Typically, we know that when we sample it close to the fetus or when we sample it close to the placenta, there can be a little variation in the values which you take. And therefore, the ISWOG guidelines in 2013, which were published for standardizing Doppler techniques, said that for the sake of simplicity and consistency, you can measure the umbilical artery in a free cord loop. So we know that typically once more than 30% of the placenta gets diseased, this is reflected in the umbilical artery as a high resistance or in a worse case, even as a reversal of flow. So that's a normal umbilical artery. That's an abnormal umbilical artery showing absent diastolic flow. And that is even more abnormal showing reversal of diastolic flow, telling us that there is a high resistance. The middle central artery is a surrogate for hypoxia. So we know that whenever there is hypoxia, there is what is known as a brain sparing effect. So what happens is moment the oxygen tension there is hypoxia, there are some chemoreceptors in the aortic isthmus which basically pick up this hypoxia and they modulate in such a way that basically more blood goes to the brain. This is classically known as a brain sparing effect, and this is basically mediated by vasodilatation of the cranial vessels. And this vasodilatation, of course, once there's dilatation, there's increase, there's less resistance. Once there's less resistance, there's increased diastolic flow, and the PI will definitely go down. So that's a normal MCA showing a fairly high resistance. And with vasodilatation, we get higher diastolic flow and a very high diastolic flow with a fall in the PI. So typically in the umbilical arteries, we are looking at an increased PI more than 95th percentile, whereas in an MCA, we are looking at a PI falling below the 5th percentile for that particular gestational age. But now we know, so first of all, let us see how the technique of the MCA. So typically MCA is easy because you just take a good BPD, keep a probe which is as much parallel to the blood flow as possible, because this is one vessel which you can actually make it parallel to your ultrasound beam. And then, of course, we try and interrogate as close to its origin. You should not go too far off in its proximal one-third. Angle correction is very important so that you get a very crisp waveform, and then you take the waveform in the middle central artery. So typically, when you're interested in velocities, like in this case, in this patient who had an RH incompatibility, it is very important to do an angle correction. Typically, when you want to measure the peak systolic velocity, we would do it manually. But when we want to do a PI, we can do it with autotrace, which is available on almost all the machines. So that's a normal umbilical MCA, and that's an abnormal MCA showing a higher diastolic flow. But now we know that instead of looking at the MCA PI, it is much better to look at what is known as cerebroplacental ratio. That means you take a ratio of umbilical of the MCA PI and compare it with the umbilical artery PI. And we know very well that even when individually the umbilical artery PI or the MCA PI are not altered, the CP ratio can get altered first, and it's now considered as a very, very sensitive criteria as compared to only umbilical artery PI or the MCA PI. Then we come to ductus venosus. Ductus venosus is a vessel which is very close to the right side of the heart, and therefore it reflects what is happening to the right side of the heart. So typically, we look at the ductus venosus. We can look at it both in longitudinal plane and transverse plane. It is easy to identify, as we'll see later. Basically, that's the umbilical vein. And typically, where the ductus starts, the umbilical vein suddenly narrows down. It almost is like one third of its size. And therefore, at this point, as we know that as blood goes through a narrow channel, there is high velocities, there is aliasing, and that is reflected in this altered color here. And typically, we like to sample it at its narrow point or at the point of maximum aliasing. So that's the umbilical vein. That's the umbilical vein ductus venosus on V mode. That's the ductus venosus on color. And you can see that there are low saturated colors in the ductus venosus. It is basically a narrow vessel, and that is the sort of a waveform which you get in the ductus venosus. Now, in the ductus venosus, we have this sort of a waveform. We have the first systole, which is known as S wave. Then we have a second a peak, which is known as a D peak, which is because of an early diastole. And then we have the A wave, which is because of the right atrial contraction. So, but what we need to understand is that persistently, the ductus venosus always shows a forward flow in one direction. And therefore, what ductus venosus reflects is what is happening in the right side of the heart. It tells us about the systole, the early diastole, and the most important is the atrial contraction. So, basically, again, in ductus, you can now take various values, PI, we can take SA, and various other ratios. What is important to understand is whatever you take is that the ductus venosus, or typically the A wave in the ductus venosus, gives us a good idea about right ventricular preload. So what do we mean by preload? A preload is the volume of blood in the ventricles at the end of the diastole. Like for example, if you have a normally functioning heart and the ventricle is able to contract adequately and push the blood out during the systole, then during diastole, there is a lot of scope for the blood to come in. So in the early phase of diastole, we have passive blood coming in from the right atrium. And in the late stage of diastole, when the right atrium contracts, we have more blood coming into the right ventricle. But when there is hypoxia, when the muscles of the heart are becoming weak, they're not able to contract adequately, then there is a lot of stagnant blood remaining in the right ventricle. And therefore, when there is this, it is time for the right atrium to push blood into the right ventricle, it is not able to do that because there's already blood there. And therefore, where does this blood go? It has to go somewhere. And therefore, it typically would find its way in a reverse direction. And this is reflected in the ductus venosus as an A wave touching the baseline, or sometimes A wave going on the other side of the baseline. So, with a decreased compliance of the heart, with increasing hypoxia, we can see that the A wave goes on falling down, comes to the baseline, or sometimes goes on the other side of the baseline. So, an abnormal ductus venosus like this not only tells us that there is not only a fetal hypoxia, but now there is fetal acidemia, and the fetus is in impending cardiac failure, or it already is in failure, and we need to deliver it out as soon as possible. So over a period of time, we know that this is one of the strongest single Doppler parameter to predict fetal death or a poor outcome. So it's a very, very important criteria. But we don't want to wait that late. We don't want to see things which are disastrous. So we want to pick up things earlier. And therefore, one more vessel which was proposed is the aortic isthmus. Now, basically, aortic isthmus is this area in the aorta just after the left subclavian artery. So what is very peculiar about this area? What is in a fetal life, typically during the systole, the blood from the left ventricle would go basically through the aortic isthmus in this direction, or a forward direction. Whereas because of the ductus, the blood from the right ventricle during the systole would go in an opposite direction. Whereas during the diastole, what decides the direction of flow in this region of the aortic isthmus is the resistance, both the systemic resistance as well as the central resistance, or the resistance in the brain. So basically, a lot of factors are going to affect the blood flow in the aortic isthmus. And therefore, this has become a very, very important sort of area to look at at what is happening all over. So typically, we sample the aortic isthmus just beyond the subclavian artery, left subclavian artery. This can be done in a longitudinal plane. We can identify the subclavian artery and then look at this relatively narrow area and then take a sample. Or we can take a three-vessel trachea view, which all of us are familiar with, and look at the aortic isthmus just at the apex of the V, and we can take the waveform in the aortic isthmus at this point also. So typically, aortic isthmus shows a forward flow, but as things become bad, and especially with redistribution, we can see that there can be an absent diastolic flow, or they can have a reversal of flow in the aortic isthmus in this part. Now, this reverse component is not good in the sense that it tells us that not good blood or bad blood is reaching the fetal brain. And once a fetus has this, again, the prognosis can be bad. And we can pick this up even before the ductus venosus becomes abnormal. So that's a normal aortic isthmus, and that's an abnormal aortic isthmus with a reversal of flow. Now, the recent guidelines, the SWOG 2020 guidelines, besides the Doppler, also show that it is very important to look at a biophysical profile scoring. So over years, we were told that we no longer do biophysical scoring, we no longer do Manning scoring. But what we need to understand is we need not look at each and every value and give scores. But while you are doing a Doppler, it's a good idea to keep a watch on the fetal gross body movements, the tone, as well as the respiratory movement, because you get an idea about how well the baby is doing inside, or whether it's looking like a sick baby. So even if you don't measure or score it as such, we can always keep a watch on the fetus. But now the recent guidelines also tell us that it may be a better idea to look at biophysical scoring. The recent guidelines also give a lot of importance to cardio tomography and the short-term variations which you could pick up. But we do not do cardio tomography in India, and therefore we need to depend heavily on Doppler. And the guidelines also mention that. The guidelines also talk of newer biochemical markers, like for example the SFLT1 to PLGF ratio, which can predict a short-term preeclampsia, in the sense that if this is abnormal, then it is likely that the patient will have a preeclampsia in the coming weeks, 1 or 2 weeks. So let's see some examples. Here we have a fetus whose weight is at 4th percentile, so less than 10th percentile, but the Doppler and the CPR and everything is normal. So we label this as a small for gestational age fetus and the age fetus. So what do we do in an HGA fetus? Typically, we need to keep a watch. We just can't leave it alone. We definitely need to keep a watch, and we try and deliver them typically at around 38 weeks of gestation and not beyond 39 weeks of gestation. So most of the HGA fetus do well. We need to follow them fortnightly with all the Doppler parameters. But some of them could have problems during labor, and therefore we need to keep a close watch even during labor. That is for small for gestational age fetus. So what we now need to do is we have looked at various parameters of Doppler. We have also looked at the biophysical profile. Maybe you have done an NST if you don't have a CCTG. And what we need to do now is put everything together and interpret things together. We can't just look at umbilical artery and say, okay, now do this, do that. We need to put all our parameters together and come to a management decision. So now we can do this management decisions in two ways. One is using what is known as a stage-based management protocol, which was made popular by Glatikos, and we can also use the new management protocols which have been published in August 2020. There's not a very significant difference between them. I'll show you the difference between them at a later stage. So let us first talk about stage-based management, which was made popular by Glatikos. So typically here, he divides them into four stages. Stage 1 is where there is a mild placental resistance, and that is reflected typically as an altered uterine artery PI or MCAPI or a CPR. Severe placental resistance, where typically we have absent diastolic flow in the umbilical artery or a reversal of flow in the aortic isthmus. Severe hemodynamic adaptation, typically when there is a reversal of flow in the umbilical artery in the diastole, or the A wave in the ductus reaches the baseline but doesn't go beyond the baseline. And stage 4, where there's a high suspicion of acidosis, where the ductus venosus shows a wave reversal. So these are the four stages. This should be read as stage 2, which were made popular by Glatikos. So let's see some examples. Here we have a 30 weeks gestation. Weight is below 10th percentile. So now you're alert. Is it HG or FGR? But we see that the uterine artery PI is high, and we can also see that the umbilical artery PI is high. So we know that this is a stage 1 FGR. So typically, what do we do in stage 1 FGR? We need to keep a close watch, typically every week, to see if things are going well. And if everything goes well, then we can induce labor at 36 weeks of gestation. And of course, but we need to keep a close watch on the fetus during the labor. So let's see second example. Here we have a 30 weeks gestation. Weight is less than third percentile. Less than third means already FGR. So you're not talking of SGA any longer. But then now you need to see how well the fetus is doing inside. We need to stage it. So what do we see here? We see umbilical artery showing absent diastolic flow and aortic isthmus also showing reversal of flow. So straight away we are in stage 2 FGR. So what do we do in stage 2 FGR? We need to keep a closer monitoring on the fetus. We need to monitor twice a week. And typically, Grant was recommended that we should deliver them around 34 weeks of gestation. Let's see another example. Now we have a 26 weeks fetus. Again, the weight is less than 23rd percentile, so straight away FGR. Now we need to stage it. So we look at Doppler. What does Doppler show? It shows reversal of flow in the diastole in the umbilical artery and the A wave in the duct is touching the baseline but not going on the other side. So this becomes a stage 3 FGR. In MC, again, you can see that there is a very high diastolic flow with a fall in the PI. So in stage 3 FGR, now we need to be even more careful and we need to monitor every 24 hours or 48 hours. And in this case, we should deliver even if the fetus has reached 30 weeks of gestation with the above findings which we discussed about. And now the fetus may not be able to take the burden of a stress of a labor and therefore it is recommended to do a C-section. Now let's go to another case. Here it's 27 weeks gestation and the weight is less than second percentile. So straight away FGR. Now we need to stage it. So we look at Doppler. And what does Doppler show? It shows everything. That means umbilical artery reversal, very high diastolic flow in the MCA, but the ductus venosus shows a pulsatile waveform with the A wave reversal. So once we say A wave reversal, that means it is a stage 4 FGR. Now we are worried not only of hypoxia, we are worried about fetal acidosis and we know that there is a high risk of fetal death. So now monitoring is absolutely short term, just 12 to 24 hours till maybe you can give steroids. And as per Gattacos guideline, even if you have reached 26th of gestation, we can deliver at a tertiary center by C-section because for them 26 weeks is a good enough maturity. Some of our ICUs do equally well as well. So here's a classical example of stage 4, umbilical artery showing reversal of diastolic flow. If you look at aortic isthmus in the aortic arch, you can see this transient reversal, which is of course seen on a spectral waveform, and the A wave in the ductus venosus again shows a reversal of flow. That's an aortic isthmus and ductus venosus showing a reversal of A wave. So that's again a stage 4 and we would like to deliver this fetus. So now this stage-based management is good only for early onset FGR, because an early onset FGR shows a classical progressive Doppler changes. So that means you have alteration in the MCA and the umbilical artery coming up first. Then of course we have changes coming up in the aortic isthmus. Then we can have absent end diastolic flow or reversal of flow in the umbilical artery. And finally we have ductus venosus abnormality. So this cascade of event is very typical of early onset FGR and should be used typically only for early onset FGR. And of course, in a late stage, you can have an abnormal NST. So we don't have CCTG, but we can definitely have an NST in our center. It's a very, very useful tool. So basically, just to summarize, as far as the stage-based management is concerned, we have four stages depending upon the Doppler finding. Stage 1, we need to do a weekly follow-up and deliver at 37 weeks. Stage 2, follow-up twice a week, deliver at 34 weeks. Stage 3, very close monitoring, maybe daily, deliver at 30 weeks. And once you reach stage 4, deliver anytime, typically anytime after 26 weeks of gestation. So the recent guidelines of ISWAC, actually, as I said, give a lot of importance to CCTG and biophysical profile besides, of course, Doppler. But there is no significant change. Here again, it says that if you have a wave reversal, going A wave going at or below baseline, if you are anywhere between 26 weeks to 28 weeks, deliver. As far as umbilical arteries are concerned, it says if you have a reversal of flow in the umbilical artery and you are anywhere between 30 and 32 weeks, deliver. And if you have an absent diastolic flow in the umbilical artery and you are anywhere between 32 and 34 weeks, deliver. So I've just put the Gattaca's stage-based management system and the recent guidelines of ISWAC together. And as you can see, that there is not a very significant change. It's a matter of just few weeks here and there. So here he is talking about 26 weeks. Here they're talking about a range between 26 to 29 weeks almost, 26 to 28 weeks. Similarly with umbilical artery showing absent diastolic flow, here we are talking of a range between 32 weeks and 32 to 34 weeks, and here of course, so if you have an umbilical artery reversal of and diastolic flow, then you should deliver as per the ISWAC guidelines at 32 weeks, but even 30 weeks is good enough. And if you have absent diastolic flow and you have reached 34 weeks, you should deliver, or even anywhere between 32 weeks and 34 weeks. So there's not a very significant change in the management strategies between stage-based management and the ISWAC guidelines. Now we come to late onset FGR. So as we said, this particular thing like stage-based management is good for early onset FGR. But when we come to late onset FGR, we need to have a different criteria and we need to be more alert. So we said earlier that late onset FGR is far more common than early onset FGR. It represents a failure of the fetus to reach its growth potential at term. Here the placental disease is very mild, and this results from Miller's immaturity rather than inadequate trophoblastic invasion as we saw. And therefore the umbilical artery Doppler indices can be unaffected. And this is the main difference between early onset and the late onset FGR. So we typically suspect late onset FGR when the individual growth curve slows down at a later stage, or there's an increase in the HC to AC ratio at a later stage. And we know that at term, the fetal vein requires more blood, more oxygen, and therefore the first hemodynamic alteration in the presence of hypoxia is an alteration in the MCAPI. And we also saw that instead of looking at only MCAPI, altered cerebroplacental ratio is much more sensitive as compared to an MCAPI. So here's an example of a late onset FGR. At 35 weeks, the HC to AC ratio is altered and the cerebroplacental ratio is very low, 0.6, telling us that there is fetal hypoxia. So what is also very important in late onset FGR when you are monitoring is a fall in the CPR. Here, for example, within a matter of about 1 or 2 weeks, there's a fall in the CPR as compared to the first ultrasound, and this is again very, very important to pick up. So the late onset FGRs lack a natural history, as we said. They do not show that cascade of events which are typical of an early onset FGR, and suddenly there can be a rapid deterioration which can give rise to a severe brain damage, and therefore we need to be very alert and pick it up at the right time. And one of the best tools to for surveillance as far as late onset FGR is concerned is an MCA Doppler and a cerebroplacental ratio. Of course, biophysical profile and NST are also important, and if you have a CCTG, then you can use that as well. So what is the ISWAC guideline? What is the recommendation? So basically, for the late onset FGR, the delivery should be based on biophysical assessment as well as, of course, maternal indications. So if you have a spontaneous, repeated, persistent, unprovoked fetal heart rate distillation or an NST, that is one indication. If you have a very bad biophysical profile, that can be another indication. Maternal indications like, of course, pre-eclampsia and HELLP, you don't wait to look at what your Doppler is showing, or obstetric emergencies, or an umbilical artery showing absent or reverse diastolic flow. So typically, as per the ISWAC guidelines for the late onset FGR, if you have reached 36 weeks to 38 weeks, and if the umbilical artery PI shows a high resistance, or the of course if the abdomen perimeter rate or the weight is below third percentile, you can deliver. If you have reached 38 to 39 weeks and you see that there is an altered cerebellar blood flow or with a low CPR, then again you need to deliver. And then, of course, because it's a late onset FGR, one can always try and induce for labor instead of going for a C-section. But during labor, it is very important to look at a fetal heart rate. As far as late onset FGR is concerned, we know that there can be, there's always a risk of neurocognitive dysfunction later on in life as well. So we need to be alert about that as well. So, but we need to understand that the stage-based protocol or the guidelines of ISWA, there cannot be nothing rigid about it. We need to individualize each case. We need to look at a maternal condition, as of course has been discussed, and each case has to be individualized, and each decision and for each fetus is going to be separate. So how can we use all this in practice? The first thing we can always do is do a good uterine artery Doppler in the first and the second trimester, so that you are aware that something is going to go wrong and you can predict a possible FGR coming in. The second thing you need to do is establish gestational age, because all the percentiles in weight are basically based on establishing the correct gestational age at an early stage. So after you have established gestational age, subsequently fetal biometry is very, very important in the correct manner, so that you pick up weight which is falling below the 10th or the 3rd percentile. So growth charts are very, very important. And finally, of course, we need to do a good Doppler, and again, we need to look at percentile charts. We need to understand that there is no effective intra-uterine treatment when it comes to FGR. So what is important is early diagnosis, good surveillance, and optimizing the time of delivery, and Doppler is again going to be a very important tool. Now, Graticos has this online sort of an app where you can enter all your findings of Doppler as well as the biometry, and then the app tells us at what stage we are and what is recommended for the sake of management. The new guidelines have these flowcharts within them. You can very well use them. But as I said, that we cannot be very rigid about such apps or such flowcharts. Each case has to be individualized. But this gives us a rough, both the system, that is the stage-based management, as well as an ISWA guideline, give us a good idea about what you should be doing in practice. But each case has to be individualized. That's very important. So it's very important to sort of optimize between the risk to the fetus versus an iatrogenic prematurity. That means you should not deliver too early, because each day in utero is important for the fetus. But if the fetus is showing signs of distress, then of course we need to have an early delivery. So what is very important is to understand all the Doppler findings and pick up things at the right time, and if the fetus shows any indication that it needs to, it would be more comfortable outside, then we need to decide on that. Thank you so much for your kind attention.